strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Hi, my name's John Downs, and welcome to another edition of On the Track. Sound of running water. Regular viewers will notice that something has changed. Look in the corner. What's happened to the printer? That horrible, expensive, ugly monstrosity that we should never have got in the first place. Well, it's been repossessed, which is always a pretty good thing to say at the height of a recession. Yes, we have money problems, but they're no worse than anybody else's. So let's stop bellyaching about it and get on with business. And the good thing is that we're no longer running a print shop, which is something I never wanted to do anyway. And I got talked into it a few years ago, much against my better judgment, by people who really should have known better. But forget all that, I want to talk about ducks. The pink-headed duck, Rhodonessa caryophyllacea, is, or was, a large diving duck. The 60-centimetre long pink-headed duck was unmistakable. It's long-bodied and long-necked with a slightly tufted head in the male and a peculiar stiff-necked posture. This duck formerly occurred in eastern India, Bangladesh and northern Burma, now Myanmar, but is probably extinct. Or is it? It was always rare and the last confirmed sighting in the wild was in 1935, although unconfirmed reports from India persisted until the early 1960s. And in the 20-odd years that we've been working at the Centre for Fortean Zoology, there have occasionally been reports which consider that this creature is not, after all, extinct. The most recent of these was a photograph that had been done by somebody called Richard Thorns. He was in the former Burma earlier this year hunting for the pink-headed duck, and when he saw this bird on a remote lake, he took a photograph of it. Is it a pink-headed duck? Well, I'd like to think so, but to be quite honest, the picture is so blurry and indistinct it's hard to tell what species it is. To give Mr. Thorns his credit, he makes no such claim, saying only that it's interesting. But as always is the case, internet pundits have jumped on it, proclaiming another great victory for cryptozoology when at this stage it isn't anything of the sort. But still on the subject of ducks, what about this, the Uber duck?
Australia harbours some of the strangest animals ever to walk this planet. And none stranger than genyornis. One day, scientists will call this the demon duck of doom.
The famous Fortean Ivan T. Sanderson was once noted for getting it into his head that a 15-foot-tall penguin was roaming around Florida. Of course it wasn't. But something just as surreal did really exist in the Pleistocene epoch of Australia. Genyornis was a 10-foot-tall, flightless, flesh-eating duck. Yes, that's right, a 10-foot-tall, flightless, flesh-eating duck. Only in Australia. The Pleistocene epoch was typified by large, strange creatures, megafauna. We had Megalania prisca, a 30-foot varanid or monitor lizard, Quincana fortarostrum, a 30-foot-long crocodile that lived on land and galloped like a horse, Nototherium, a marsupial rhinoceros, Diprotodon, a giant wombat, and strangest of all, genyornis. Now, before you get it into your head that this looked like a 10-foot-tall rabid daffy duck, it didn't. It looked more like an enormous ratite relative to the ostriches and emus. But of course it wasn't. It was in fact a waterfowl, a duck, but one designed to chase down, kill and eat living prey. A remarkable creature.
But from genyornis to Jenny Lindsay, the landlady of the Farmer's Arms, the pub in our village. Because the other morning, still staying on the subject of ducks, Jenny was not best pleased when she came downstairs to find that her husband Alan had installed a large white duck in her restaurant.
I found him at half two this morning. He was quacking away for his life. He was being stalked by cats. The cats disappeared, of course, in my presence. And I thought to myself, he's a pet duck, but he ran away, so I was chasing him around this village between half 2 and 3 o'clock this morning. Eventually caught hold of him and then brought him into this establishment where he's been ever since. That's about it, really.
When I woke up, my dad told me we had a duck, but I didn't really believe it. And then I went down and I seen it, and it just keeps running away.
Jenny Lindsay, a bit like my own wife, Karina, is a remarkable woman who puts up with the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or perhaps that really should be the slings and arrows of outrageous husbands, because Alan is as notorious for doing stupid things as I am, and putting a duck in the middle of the pub restaurant must be one of the best. However, the little fellow was soon claimed by Charlie, a nice South African dude who runs an animal sanctuary at the other end of the village. And so, life in Wolseley going back to normal. Why are we telling you about the duck? Well, quite simply because although on this occasion it wasn't us who did the rescuing, our animal rescue work is becoming increasingly important as the CFZ influence spreads across North Devon. And so, like we do with Beth at the Animal Hospital, we like to showcase the actions of people who've done something nice for the creatures who shared the natural world with us. Well done, Alan. Well done, Jenny. And well done, Clarissa. Okay, boys. David, what are you doing? What have you been doing?
We went into Biddeford and got a bath from the recycling centre.
Because you asked us to.
And what's the bath for, Matthew?
I've no idea.
Matthew.
Another one of your harebrained schemes. But it's okay, Brain, because tomorrow we take over the world.
Yeah.
Where do you want it?
Up outside the museum. To you guys, it may look like a crappy old bath. It cost me 9 to 15 quid. But to us, it is the new CFZ Museum outside turtle enclosure.
What are you going to do, all?
Okay, we've just set up our new turtle pond outside and we're going to be moving a slider and our unknown species of turtle, whose name is Cuthbert, into the new turtle pond now. There's already a slider Gladys, and she's usually in quite bad temper, so we're quite lucky that she's not hissing at us today. Let's see if she likes her new home.
Hold on, can I get a still shot here? Okay.
And then it was the turn of Cuthbert, a specimen of a completely unknown species. Cuthbert and Gladys have been with us since 2003, when they were sent to us on a breeding loan by the University of Portsmouth. There was originally a third terrapin called Spots, of exactly the same type and colour variation as Cuthbert, but Spots sadly died some years ago. and his body is still in the deep freeze in Home Court, my house in Exeter, which is soon to become a home to my youngest stepdaughter and her boyfriend Ivan. I think maybe I should remove the dead turtle before they move in, or else she is going to accuse me of being even more eccentric than she already thinks that I am.
When most people think about cryptozoology, they think about big, spectacular creatures like sea serpents, yetis, Sasquatch, lake monsters, giant ground sloths, things like that. Creatures that we would deem to be monsters. And I make no bones that, personally, that's what interests me the most. The big, scary, strange, exciting stuff. But things don't have to be big to be exciting. Lots of cryptids are small. And we have a small cryptid right with us here. A turtle that's completely unknown to science. None of the experts we've shown it to know what the hell it is, and neither do we. So that just goes to show that a cryptid can literally fall into your lap. It can be in your backyard, and it doesn't have to be a 100-foot long sea serpent. It can be just about anything, as long as it's unknown to science.
We have several colonies of exotic cockroaches here at the CFZ, at least two of which are undescribed. That is, species that haven't been given a proper Latin scientific name. And this month, we're pleased to be able to announce that we've had a birth. Well, 65 of them, actually. We have 65 Madagascan hissing cockroach babies, which just popped out from their mum earlier in the month. Add to that something over a dozen baby spiny mice so far this year, and something like 35 yellow-bellied giardinas, the little fish from Cuba that we showed you a couple of months ago, and we're not doing badly at all on the breeding stakes in 2009. One of the reasons that we're breeding so many exotic animals at the moment is our outreach projects. Now, we are in the process of establishing static displays consisting of posters, information leaflets and tanks of living animals in as many different tourist attractions and shops as we possibly can, all across North Devon. The idea is to try to showcase what we do and to showcase the dazzling biodiversity which exists in the world, which is why we're trying to breed animals which aren't commonly found in pet shops and people usually don't get the chance to see. However, for much of this month, I've been being a film director.
Action!
Firstly, there's a really good book here about mystery cats written about my good friend Carl Schuker. It's about 20 years old and very valuable, so you must look after it.
Action!
What colour would you say it was?
Go!
As you can see, I'm not just shamelessly exploiting two young actresses, Emily, 15, and her younger sister Jessica, 12. I'm also exploiting my beloved wife Karina and my best mate Graham as well. But I tell you what, it is shaping up to be one hell of a film. Of all the films I've ever made, I think this is my favourite. And it helps that Emily herself is so enthusiastic about what's going on. So, Hun, tell me, what is it that interests you about the whole subject?
Just everything, you know, just like where they come from, who brought them here, just everything. I love just the cats in general.
What do you hope to achieve out of this film? Would you like to actually see one?
Yeah. It'd be pretty cool to see it actually in the wild instead of in a zoo.
How would you feel if you actually see one?
Probably be scared, but amazed.
Fantastic. How long have you been interested in this stuff? How long have you been interested in the whole subject?
Years, since I was little.
The film tells the only slightly fictionalised account of what happened after Emily's Uncle Robert had an encounter with a big cat out here at Huddersfield Woods, and how Emily and her friends get obsessed with the mystery and do their best to solve it.
Yeah, so this is about here where it was. About here, actually. And we can see the hole in the bank, and the reason why I know, because the further down is where there's a tree. So I took the markings from it back then. So obviously I was coming down the road then in the morning. And it's a lot different now because there's no wood. There's no woods over there now. This is all woods. 3 years ago, it all got chopped down. This is totally different. I must have never seen anything since then. especially along this road here. These are all due to be cut down now in the next 2 years, these trees. So I'll pull in here over that. Yeah, so basically when I put the van on main beam, it was just right here in front of me. And for 2 seconds it just leaked off in over the bank here. What was lots and lots of trees and woods there back then, it's all been cut down 2 years ago.
So it's like this stuff right here.
Disappear, yeah, but the bank was a lot different then, so this has all been put up by a tractor and machinery now, so it's totally different to what it was before. And the road was a lot thinner. There was just no, the banks were closer. But yeah, that's where it was.
Whether anybody picks up on the semi-pun between Emil and the detectives and Emily and the big cats, or whether indeed that's just a pun that only exists in my head, I don't know. But I tell you what, it's going to be a cracking film. But our big cat research this month isn't just taking place as part of this movie. We've also got several other projects ongoing.
Right, can you tell me where you found this print and when?
It was in Cheviot, Devon. It was about 4 weeks ago, maybe. It was down a bridge. The area is called sort of Lashbrook, sort of near Black Torrington, right area. There's like a little bridge, little humpback bridge, a bit of a river going through it. And me and mate sort of walked around there, just off the side of the road. It wasn't any distance away. It was print just in this little bit of mud light. Yeah, that was the only one we saw. We couldn't find any other decent sized prints. There was like a couple, but it wasn't like very noticeable. But yeah, that was where we found that.
And can you tell me something about the sightings?
Well, in Cheviot, there's been quite a few sightings, I would say about a year ago. There's this one woman who came back from milking, like afternoon milking, and she was driving up the hill into Cheviot. It was sort of getting dusk sort of time, and apparently it jumped out in front of her over the edge onto the road, sort of went along the road, and then was off again, and she didn't do anything about it. She sort of stopped the car and thought, that's that, and drove on,
Did she say what colour it was?
She said it was black, quite dark black. It was quite long, big, but I think she said meant like it was longer, and it was quite very long. And then there's been another sort of, I wouldn't say sighting, but something else happened. There's near that area where she saw the cat, a woman went to go bring in her horses one day, and the horses' rugs were ripped down the back, they were ripped and it's all proper tears. One bite, just a corner sort of tear, when you rip your clothes, it's proper big scratches down the back, and horses' backs were a bit bloody as well.
Have you ever seen anything yourself?
No, I haven't seen anything. I thought I saw something once when I was out on my horse, so I was walking on the road. And I looked up into another field, and there's something big and black sort of just bounced along. It wasn't running like a dog run, it sort of run like a cat. But it was only sort of glimpsing light, and I sort of wondered what the hell that was. And by the time I got up there, I couldn't see anything,
Okay, thanks, mate.
Max has sent us this cast of a print, possibly from a big cat. Apparently it was taken about a year ago in Hastings. That's all I know about it so far. Having looked at it, it does look very cat-like, and I'll tell you why it looks cat-like. It has this rounded central pad, whereas if it were a dog, it would be very concave here at the back. Cats bulge out like that, that's very distinctive for a cat. Also, the toes are asymmetrical, whereas the toes of a dog are much more symmetrical and usually show the blunt claws. I've seen cat prints like this before, where the toes are quite well separated in soft ground, particularly this second toe here, and the space between them looks quite distinctive. I couldn't tell you what it was. It looks like puma, but don't hold me to that. It looks very much like some sort of large cat rather than a dog.
Talking of dogs, not that we were really, this is Biggles' first summer and he's massively enjoying the fact that he can go out every day and rampage around the garden. He can even roll around on the lawn with his old dad on occasions, and it's lovely for me to be able to have a dog to roughhouse with for the first time in many years. But he's still a puppy, and like any young person or adolescent, he's testing his boundaries, in this case literally, because he's doing his best to break out of the garden at every possible opportunity. So, Graham, who's never been a hedger before, is finding himself thrown in at the deep end, having to try to strengthen the borders of the CFZ grounds to make them dog-proof.
Garden twine to form a sort of, well, I won't say natural trellis, but a sort of criss-cross pattern. And the mesh is acting as a sort of backup to that, in a way. I'm operating in a very constricted space here between the fencing that actually is to keep the livestock contained in that field, and our boundary hedge, which is here, and it's a rather overgrown gap really, but it's just enough room for me to operate.
Well, hopefully that'll do the trick, and it's got to be said, in the last week or so since Graham did the hedge, the dog has not escaped once. However, we have some sad news for you this month.
So, I'm going to bring up my next door neighbour, who happens to be the chairman of the village hall. But because he is my next door neighbour, and I have been taking the mick out of him for many years, Richard's going to extemporise an introduction.
You might know this gentleman as Mr. Rickard, but to the world in general, he's better known by his old Victorian music hall name of Parking Chops. And they used to do a wonderful old musical hall act that he's going to recreate here today. It's Parking Chops and his Meat Cavalcade.
Right. Stuart Rickard.
Thank you very much, Richard. That's probably the weirdest introduction I've ever had. But what do you expect on a weekend like this? Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, a belated welcome to Woolsey Community Hall. We're very proud of this establishment, as Richard was saying. I'm the Chairman of Trustees.
Literally this morning, on the 31st of May, as we were putting the final touches to this episode of On the Track, we received the news that our good friend Stuart Rickard, our neighbour for the last 4 years, finally lost his battle with kidney cancer. He was a great guy, we'll miss him a lot, and he did a lot of good work around the village. And for one thing, the weird weekend cocktail party is never going to be the same again, because we'll never have him capering around the garden, drinking all my tequila and making bad jokes. Stuart, rest in peace, buddy, we'll miss you. Well, now it's time to take our regular monthly look at new and rediscovered species. Two new species of agamid lizards in the family of horned dragons, or rather mountain horned dragons, have been described from peninsular Malaysia. Acanthosaura titwangiensis and Ankathosaura bithangiensis were described from specimens caught in Perak earlier this year. So far, this has been a remarkable year for new amphibian species. Earlier in the year, 10 new frog species were announced from Sri Lanka and another 10 from Colombia, but the news in early May took the figurative biscuit. Science Daily wrote, between 129 and 221 new species of frog have been identified in Madagascar, practically doubling the current known amphibian fauna. The findings suggest that the number of amphibian species in Madagascar, one of the world's biodiversity hotspots, has been significantly underestimated. According to the researchers, if these results are extrapolated at a global scale, the number of amphibian species worldwide could double. This just goes to show that we only know a fraction of what the natural world has to show us. There are three species of right whale, so called because once upon a time they were considered to be the right species to hunt. Their large baleen whales belong to the genus Eubalaena, and the three species are the North Atlantic right whale, the North Pacific right whale, and the Southern right whale. A new population of the North Atlantic right whale has just been discovered. Using a team of underwater hydrophones that can record sounds from hundreds of miles away, a team of scientists from Oregon State University and the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration has documented the presence of these critically endangered whales in an area where they were once thought to be extinct. The discovery is particularly important, researchers say, because it's in an area that may be open to shipping if the melting of polar ice continues as it is expected to do. The scientists are unsure of exactly how many whales are in the region, which is off the southern tip of Greenland and site of an important 19th century whaling area called Cape Farewell Ground, but they recorded more than 2,000 right whale vocalizations in the region from July through to December 2007. The technology has enabled us to identify an important unstudied habit for endangered right whales, they say, and it continues to raise the population that, contrary to general belief, a remnant of a central or eastern Atlantic stock of right whales still exists and may well be viable, says David Mellinger, an assistant professor at the Hatfield Marine Science Centre in Newport and chief scientist of the project. We don't know how many right whales there are in the area, Mellinger added. There aren't individually distinctive in their vocalizations, but we did hear right whales at three widely spaced sites on the same day, so the absolute minimum is three, and even that number is significant, because the entire population of the species is estimated to be only 300 to 400 whales. Well, guys, that's about it for this episode. I want to say thank you to a lot of people this time round, because my camera people alone this time have been Richard, Graham, Max, Matthew, Emma, Dave, Ol, and my darling wife, Karina. I want to say thank you to the guys up at the Farmer's Arms, especially for the good work they did rehabilitating the duck. I want to say thank you to everybody who has helped us. And I want to send a message to the people like the capitalist scum who have just repossessed our printer. What we do is not about the money. This is about trying to do something good with our lives. If we all pull together as a team, we are going to be able to survive this appalling recession. If we don't, and if we just try to grab each other's coattails, try to cause trouble for each other, and try to grab money back using the letter rather than the spirit of the law, we shall go down. But together we can and will achieve remarkable things. So until next time, seeing you.